One of the important things to understand about solution behavior has to do with something called the Le Chatelier principle. It describes an equilibrium in solutions. Now, equilibriums apply to a lot of different things, but in solutions, we're talking about how the behavior is balanced out. In particular, we're talking about what's called a dynamic equilibrium. So a dynamic equilibrium is one in which change is constantly occurring, but there's nevertheless a balance. Le Chatelier discovered something about systems in equilibrium, but first we need to talk about what an equilibrium is. And really, in chemistry, when we talk about equilibriums, we're most often talking about dynamic equilibrium. So let me define equilibrium and then dynamic equilibrium, okay? So an equilibrium is kind of a balance between two things. It's kind of a balance between two things, okay? The reason you can stand up and walk is because there's an equilibrium in your head. You know, part of your ear canal is all based on whether you're standing up level or not, okay? So there's an equilibrium involved. And so your brain interprets that equilibrium about whether you're standing up straight or not, and then your body responds to keep you from tipping over one side or the other. Okay, that's an equilibrium. But in chemistry, we're really talking about a dynamic equilibrium. And dynamic means change. Okay, dynamic means change. So dynamic equilibrium means there's both change and a balance. Okay, so there's a constant change going on, but that constant change doesn't result in a change in the amounts of the two sides of the equilibrium. Okay, if you think of tipping over when you're standing up as left being one thing and right being the other, well, if you tip over, you're going too much to the left and the right. Okay, in a dynamic equilibrium, there's constant change going on, but the balance of chemicals or whatever the thing is we're discussing here stays the same. And this is a very important concept. The reason that we have weather, you know, we had some tornado warnings and a bunch of tornadoes in the Midwest here right before we recorded this video, before this lesson. And the whole reason there's weather on our planet has to do with the fact the planet is trying to reach equilibrium. The planet's turning around. Only part of the planet's facing the sun. The places that face the sun most directly get the highest amount of heat transfer to the atmosphere. The atmosphere wants to equalize that temperature. And so the wind blows to try and equalize that temperature. That's a simplified way of saying it. But the whole reason, all these weather systems are based on all that. The rotation of the Earth creates a momentum. All these things go into why the weather systems change. Okay, it's why the geography affects the weather. Okay, why it is that we tend to have snow here sometimes and we don't. It's based on those weather systems, the wind blowing, the whole fronts coming in around the base of the Appalachian Mountains and so forth. All that's about having to do with equilibrium. The reason the pH in your blood stays at a constant 7.4 or close to that anyway has to do with the equilibrium system in your body. So equilibrium is a really, really, really important thing for you to understand, okay? And the kind of equilibrium we're talking about with all these things is a constant change that results in a balance, all right? So let's talk about what that means in terms of solutions, since that's where we are right now in our discussion of chemistry, okay? So let's assume that we have in this beaker some kind of liquid. We'll just say it's water, okay? And we put some sugar in here. All right, it's like we're making sweet tea. We're in the South. Sweet tea is a staple. We can talk about sweet tea here. So you put in sugar, and you keep putting in sugar, and you keep stirring it, and keep putting in more sugar, and keep stirring it. Eventually, what's going to happen? Reach a point where no more sugar can be dissolved. And so if you stirred it, and the sugar won't dissolve, it's going to form a little pile here in the center because of the vortex in that stirred solution, okay? So there's our sugar at the bottom, all right? Here's a neat thing you can try at home. Take some water and stir it up into sugar. I'm sorry, take some sugar and stir it up into water and keep stirring the sugar in the water until you can't dissolve anymore. And so there's going to be some sugar at the bottom. Okay? Cover the top. Just put a saucer or something on top so it doesn't evaporate out. And come back 2 days later. But look very carefully at what the sugar looks like before you leave it and when you come back. Now here's what you're going to see. That this pile of sugar that was in small crystals, say about a half a millimeter and across each edge, when you come back, this pile of sugar is not going to be there anymore, but there's going to be a powder layer of sugar across the whole bottom. So those crystals don't exist. The crystals that are going to be there are really, really, really tiny crystals that you can't even hardly tell they're crystals anymore. And here's why. Because while it looks like you can't dissolve any more sugar, what's really happening is this sugar keeps dissolving. So the sugar keeps becoming part of the solution. It's dissolving. It's going into solution. Each of those molecules of sugar are breaking apart from the whole crystal and being dissolved, solvated into this solution. Okay? Solvated into the solvent. But the reason you can't seem to dissolve anymore is because while you're always dissolving sugar, sugar from the solution is always being deposited. And so at this temperature, so this whatever this water happens to be, at room temperature would be about 22 degrees C, the rate at which we're making solute particles in the solution is equal to the rate at which we're making deposited particles on the bottom. So precipitation is occurring at the same rate that dissolution is occurring. Does that make sense? So there's constant change, but the amount of sugar dissolved in the water doesn't change because we're making as many solute particles as we are depositing. Yes?
What was that arrow pointing down?
Because we're depositing sugar. So sugar molecules that are dissolved are coming out of the solution and being deposited on the bottom. Because it's dissolving. Because it's depositing. And the rate at which these two are happening is equal. So it doesn't look like we're dissolving anything, but in fact, we're dissolving all the time and depositing all the time, so the amount of sugar in the solution doesn't change. Does that make sense? Now you can imagine it like this. We're in high school, we have an A wing and a B wing. Okay? The bell rings and people change classes. There are people coming from B wing over to A wing and people go from A wing over to B wing. But the number of people in each wing stays relatively the same. Does that make sense? Because while there's change going on, the amount of people in each wing stays about the same. Does that make sense? That's what's happening here. And so there's a dynamic equilibrium. There's no, you know, nobody gets to class and stops, okay? The sugar particles that are dissolving and depositing are constantly in motion. Dynamic equilibrium. A balance because the number of sugar molecules in the solution doesn't change. Dynamic because the particles that are becoming soluted and are solvated and the particles that are being deposited are happening. These are happening at the same rate. Does that make sense? Yes? Okay, you can go to look at the interstate any day you want to. People go one way and people go the other way. The number of people on either end of the interstate about the same all the time. That makes sense? Okay. All right. That's what an equilibrium is. It's a balance. In chemistry, the kind of equilibriums we deal with are dynamic equilibriums. So there's constant change, but a balance nevertheless. All right. How would I change the amount or number of solute particles I can dissolve in this amount of solvent? What could I do to this to cause it to change? The amount I can dissolve. Heat it up. Well, when I heat it up, I'm changing the point of equilibrium. Okay? Now, Le Chatelier would have called that a pressure. By the way, it's usually discussed in higher level chemistry is we're putting a pressure on one side of the equilibrium. If the equilibrium is thought of as being kind of a seesaw, okay? And on one side we've got deposited sugar, and on the other side we've got dissolved sugar, okay? So if the balance point is right here at 22 degrees C, roughly room temperature, if I heat it up to 50 degrees C, the balance point's going to shift, okay? Let's say I'm going to have more dissolved, so I'm going to shift my balance point over here. Does that make sense? So what happens when you heat it up is you change the point of equilibrium. But as long as there's enough sugar, you're going to establish a new equilibrium. The balance is going to change, but there's still going to be an equilibrium where we're constantly dissolving sugar, constantly depositing sugar, as long as we don't have so little sugar that we can't. We use it all up when we heat it up. Does that make sense? Still a dynamic equilibrium, still constant change, but a new balance form. More solute dissolved in the solvent. Does that make sense? All right. So when we have this situation where we've got all the sugar we could possibly dissolve in this amount of solvent at this temperature, we have what's called a saturated solution. We have all the solute that we could possibly dissolve in a given amount of solvent at a given temperature. We've got a saturated solution. Okay? So, drink sweet tea with saturated sugar. That's pretty sweet tea, right? Don't like that. I just can't drink tea that sweet. Okay? Got that? That makes sense? All right? So I want to dilute it. If I dilute it so I don't have all the sugar I can possibly dissolve in that amount of water, or all the solute I can possibly dissolve in a given amount of solvent, then I have an unsaturated solution. It's not saturated. It's unsaturated. Or it hasn't risen to the point of being saturated. It's unsaturated. Yes?
Is that like how you got sweet tea and you put ice in it and the water, the ice melts and it's unsaturated?
Yes. You can think of it that way. So the illustration that's being asked about here is if I have sweet tea and I put ice in it, the ice melts, dilutes the solution. It would start out as saturated if I had dissolved all the sugar I could possibly dissolve in that amount of tea. And then I put ice in there and it melts, dilutes it, then it's unsaturated. Yeah, you could say that. Huh? Then you could put more sugar in there. Sure. Okay. So you need to know the difference between saturated and unsaturated. Okay. There's also a term called supersaturation we'll get to in a little bit. All right, we'll come back to that. You with me? All right. I want to talk about another case of saturation and this equilibrium that happens for a similar situation, but a little bit different. Let's say I've got an amount of liquid in here, okay, and I'm going to seal up the top. So I'm going to take some of that plastic material we have back there to seal up things, okay? Maybe I'm going to use saran wrap or something, or something else is going to seal up the top so that no stuff can get out the top. All right. What is evaporation? What's happening in evaporation?
Water changes to gas.
Water changes to gas. Actually, water changes to vapor, but it's kind of the same thing. Okay. It becomes a gas if the temperature is at or above the boiling temperature of the liquid. But if we're below the boiling temperature of the liquid, we call it a vapor. Okay. The way the molecules behave is a lot the same. All right. But what I want to know is, when I say what's happening with evaporation, is what's happening to the molecules that make up this liquid when it evaporates? How do they become a gas? What happens? It's a real simple answer here. We're not looking for a complex answer. Huh? They break apart. Some of those molecules of whatever that liquid is are moving fast enough and are near enough to the surface, they escape. Anybody ever played Red Rover? Okay, what's Red Rover? Y'all know what that is? Mm-hmm. No? Tell them what Red Rover is.
You have two lines of people that are facing each other, holding hands. You say, Red Rover, Red Rover,
and
whoever, and
they're like, okay, so if you think of the surface of the liquid as one of those lines where people are holding hands, and the molecule as being the one they call over, they're trying to penetrate through that surface. Okay? Make sense? So they got to move fast, don't they, to get through there. All right, they're gonna go through there, and they're gonna become what you said was a gas we call a vapor. Okay, so the more molecules I have escaping, the more evaporation I have. Yes, but I've sealed the top. So what I've got is a situation where I can only get so many gas molecules, or vapor molecules, to be more correct in the terminology. So many vapor molecules up here, it kind of stops, because at the same time I'm creating vapor molecules, what you don't see is vapor molecules that are becoming part of the liquid. They're condensing. They're moving slow enough. They strike the surface. They stick there. They stay with the liquid. Okay? So there's constantly stuff escaping, constantly stuff being condensed. Okay? And if I reach a point where the rate at which I'm making gaseous or vapor molecules is the same rate at which I am taking those vapor molecules and putting them back into the liquid or condensing, I've got a saturated solution up here. I've got a liquid dissolved in a gas, but it's still saturated whenever that happens. Okay? But the process isn't stopping. There's constantly molecules leaving and becoming vapor, and vapor molecules are constantly leaving this gaseous or vapor state and becoming condensed into that liquid. All the time. But the balance, the amount of vapor in this gas doesn't change overall, but it's constantly changing as far as individual molecules are concerned. Does that make sense? Dynamic equilibrium. What would I do to change the point of this equilibrium? Can I do anything to change that equilibrium so I can dissolve, say, more vapor molecules in this gas? Heat it. Same answer, right? Okay. So I can heat it. I can get more vapor molecules up here. And so we'll increase the number of vapor molecules until the point at which the number of vapor molecules becoming condensed equals the rate at which the molecules are leaving and becoming a vapor, and we have a new point of equilibrium. We've moved our fulcrum point again. Does that make sense? Still an equilibrium, just a different balance, different point of balance. Does that make sense? Everybody with me? Okay. Now, there's lots of different equilibriums. Okay. We're only talking about those equilibriums that apply to, in a simple explanation, that apply to solutions, because that's where we are right now in our study of chemistry. Okay? There's lots of other examples we can use. Okay? Just so that I've given you kind of a preview, if you're going to be taking AP chemistry, since this is an honors chemistry class we're talking about here, the way that you calculate that balance point, we call it the constant for equilibrium. And there's a lot of different of these subscripts I could put down here. I could put, you know, any chemical I wanted to down here, whatever. We always calculate that in the same way in chemistry. And that's always molar concentration of whatever the reactants, wait a minute, products of either our chemical or physical reaction over molar concentration of reactants. Okay? Always products over reactants. Always. Got that? That'll kind of help if you remember that. Always products over reactants. All right? So let's go back up here and look at our sugar. The amount of sugar that's dissolved is the product. Because you start out a solid sugar, you dissolve it. Okay, that's a physical reaction. That's not a chemical reaction, it's sugar. So our molar concentration of whatever is dissolved goes over the molar concentration of whatever solid we put in here to try to dissolve it to begin with. That makes sense? If we're talking about dissolving sugar, our equilibrium point will be the molar concentration of products over the molar concentration of reactants. So the amount of the concentration of the stuff we actually got dissolved divided by the molar concentration of stuff we started with when we started trying to dissolve it. Okay? Chemical reactions are a little bit different. We have to have both the all the products on the top and all the reactants. I'm sorry. Yeah, all the reactants on the bottom. That's right. Okay? Does that make sense? All right. But we don't do that in this class at this time. I'm just giving you a heads up that that's where it's headed. If you want to know how we figure out where this fulcrum point is, this is it. That makes sense? There's a mathematical way of calculating what that fulcrum point for our balance is. Any questions? All right. Now let's talk about supersaturated. So, if a saturated solution is the maximum amount of solute we can dissolve in a given amount of solvent, supersaturated means I went beyond that point. The question is, how can I go beyond what's the maximum amount? Well, we've got to go back to our original definition and refine that a little bit. Okay? A better way of defining saturated is the maximum amount of solute we can dissolve in a given amount of solvent at normal conditions. That's all I want to add. At normal conditions. So I've tricked the conditions to get more in there than I should be able to. All right, so if I'm dissolving sodium acetate, Sodium ions are Na+. Acetate is CH3CH2O-. Okay, remember those? You're supposed to memorize those things. Those are two ions you're supposed to know from memory. Well, actually, this one should be figured out from the periodic table. Put it together, and I get sodium acetate. All right? But if I'm going to dissolve it, okay, this makes a solid. That's that crystal you were seeing. If I want to dissolve it, then water molecules are going to be attracted to both the sodium ion and the acetate ion. Okay, what's the difference? Remember, when we solvate an ionic substance with water, water molecules polar. So the end of the water molecule where the oxygen is located is negative, and the corners here where the hydrogen atoms are located on the water are more positive. These are partial positive and partial negative ends. In fact, there's actually two negative parts where the two lone pairs of electrons are located. Y'all remember talking about this? Okay? No? I hope you remember it, because you got to know it for the test Thursday. So the negative end of the water molecule is attracted to the positive ion of sodium, and the positive end of the water molecule is attracted to the negative ion of acetate. And so what happens is those positive ions, like the sodium, get surrounded by the water molecules. The water molecules arrange themselves so the negative end is toward that positive ion. Okay? And that's solvation for the positive ion. But the same thing's happening with the negative ion. With the negative ion, the positive part of the water molecule is attracted. And so both kinds of ions, positive and negative ions, get solvated, surrounded by the water molecules. That's the process of solvation for ionic substances in water. We talked about three different kinds of solvation we were discussing at the beginning of this unit. Okay? So the sodium ions and the acetate ions are dissolved in the water because of this sort of skin or film of water molecules around it. Okay? And so it kind of makes it kind of hard for them to get back together. But when I'm pouring the solution into that dish, I'm shocking it. I'm pushing some ions together. And once I start it going, it keeps going. It creates a kind of a cascade. Once I start these crystals growing, they keep growing. So in the video then, they just keep on growing longer and longer and longer. When you react a supersaturated solution of sodium acetate to get it to precipitate out and form those nice white crystals and stuff, to see all that neat stuff. When these things combine back together, they're releasing heat. Okay, the only reason I bring that up is two more units from now, we're going to be in thermochemistry. Okay, and in thermochemistry, we're going to learn about how breaking bonds is always an energy-absorbing process. Making bonds is always an energy-releasing process. So the fact that we create heat when we make this supersaturated solution that then forms these crystals, we put all these crystals back together, these ions back together to make these crystals, the fact that it releases heat is just illustrating the fact that forming bonds is heat-releasing. It's exothermic. Forming bonds is exothermic. Breaking bonds is endothermic. You got that? Like, you understand what I'm saying? By endothermic and exothermic? All right. Now, so supersaturated just means you've sort of tricked everything so you can dissolve more than you normally can. And the way we trick this solution is by surrounding each of these ions with this layer of water molecules that keeps it from coming back out of solution, which you would normally do. Normally, you wouldn't be able to even get there. Does that make sense? And you do that by heating it up, getting it dissolved in that higher temperature, because we can do that. We can change the point of equilibrium. When we cool it back down, this skin or bubble of water molecules prevents those ions from coming back together unless you shock it or you can seed it. So if we go back to our video for a minute, at the point where he started to make that little tower right there, the existing crystals down here seeded or began the crystallization process for the stuff he poured on top.